Hello everyone, and welcome back to Laurence Plays Factorio Space Exploration. And welcome back to the rather lovely winter holiday destination of Frost. Yes, this is the planet I landed on in the last episode, and things have gone quite well. There have been a few hiccups, but let's have a bit of a run through what we've done. So, in the last episode, I landed rather spectacularly over here in my little rocket ship. And I used my roboports here to dump all of the stuff I picked up, all the stuff I brought with me, into these chests, just, you know, for easy access and stuff. That went okay. Got a load of stuff from that. I then built up a power array up here to power the roboports and whatnot. Unfortunately, I then realised I hadn't actually. There are a few things about this planet I hadn't checked. One of them is that there's only, where is it, Frost? Here we go. Only 22%. Solar power on this planet, which probably makes a certain amount of sense, given that maybe that's, you know, why it's so cold here, and it's a frost planet because it doesn't get very much sunlight. So yeah, I mean, I have to admit that does make a certain amount of sense. I can't complain too much. The other thing I noticed a little bit too late is this iron ore amount down here. There's a sort of really, really low quantities of iron on this planet, not to put too fine a point on it. So I brought a fair amount of supplies with me, lots and lots of belts, literally thousands of belts, a load of pipes and things. Unfortunately, if I zoom out a bit, you'll see that stuff is rather spread out here. So I had some issues with that. Anyway, I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. So these solar panels weren't producing very much power at all. I've run a power cable out from them anyway, and I decided to resort back to sort of very, very early game methods of power generation. So over here on this side of the Lake of Doom, I've got a little coal mine hooked up directly to a load of steam engines to produce the power I need. And yeah, they're doing pretty well. They've got my accumulators fully charged. They're producing enough power. Basically, it is only just enough power. It's not an enormous amount over what I need. So I may go over and put some more steam engines in over here. As you can see, there's room in here for a few more. Because these are running more or less flat out, especially as it's nighttime at the moment. I also need to finish off this mine. There's quite a lot of gaps in the miners around here because not to put too fine a point on it, I ran out of them. And the other things that I was mining seemed more important, so I thought I'd concentrate on those. Speaking of other things, well, I started off with an iron mine here. That's why I started here. There was a little patch of about 70,000 iron here, which anyone who's played Factorio will know that 70,000, not really all that much. So I thought I'd grab that anyway, because my plan was to use the iron in order to build the pods for the delivery cannon capsules, as you see in this diagram here. It requires a certain amount of steel to build them to go into the low density structures. So I've pulled all this up, there is quite a lot of steel in here, because all of these have got, well, some of these have got like 100 steel in them because they're filled up to capacity, and this belt's full. In fact, I need to make that while I think of it. Let's input priority left on that one. There we go. Yeah, so I turned all that entire iron patch into steel, and then I realised I didn't have enough iron with me, I didn't have enough pipes with me, I didn't have enough belts with me, so I ended up needing a bit more iron. So I've been grabbing, I pulled a little bit off to the side. That's what this belt was doing. There were a couple of furnaces down here turning that into iron plates, so I could make a few pipes of desperation. But before that, I took a lot of belts with me. That's how I've got this ridiculous thing here, going down to the stone mine down here, which is, there's 3.5 million stone down here that's going to last for ages, even if I am only pulling off half of the patch. So that's pulling stone out, as you can see, and then there's this stupidly long belt going up here. And in hindsight, maybe I should have used railway lines for this. I'm not sure off the top of my head which uses more iron per square travelled, a belt or a railway line. A railway line gets much higher throughput because you can whack a train down it at high speed and several trains as well, and that sort of thing. But as far as iron used per square, it's quite possible that belts are actually just as good. I also, on the way past, grabbed this copper patch because you need a small amount of copper as well. That's obviously producing more than enough, so I've got a second belt of that coming up here. Then off to the north, I've got another coal mine, because it seemed easier to go up to this one up here, this sort of bird or ghost shaped one of nearly 5 million, than to run a belt round the top of this lake. To be honest, I don't think it makes a lot of difference there. It's going to be about the same distance. And the reason I built this one up over here was because I wanted coal and water close together, so I didn't have to do too much building before I could get things up and running, because I was a bit desperate for power. So, up here also is a nice big cryonite patch, 19 million. I wasn't sure quite how quickly I was going to get through it, but turns out not very. And so, all of these are feeding down here, and I've got a little bus going on here for the just for the specific things I need for this particular job. Down here we've got the coal being steamed into various types of oil. Now this is the coal liquefaction. It requires a little bit of heavy oil to get it started, so I brought some up in barrels, dumped it into this tank, and that was enough to bootstrap it, get it running, and then it just feeds round and round, and the heavy oil gets very slowly used. Gets passed around, and you get more out than you put in, so it you can just leave it running. All you need to put in is steam and coal. Then I've also got, because that produces all three of the oil types, heavy, light and petrol, we've got then the standard crackers here, turning the heavy oil into light and turning the light oil into petroleum gas. And making sure these two should stay at up to 20,000. This one will fill up. This one's gone a bit over, presumably because I'm not using the petroleum gas up quickly enough. That's getting turned into sulfur and plastic, which gets turned into other things down here. We've got the sand being turned into stone, being turned into sand and into glass here, because that's needed for the low density structures. That seems to be the one thing that isn't massively faster than required, but it is going quickly enough, so I'm not too bothered. We're then also making explosives and heat shield plates, stone tablets, then heat shield plates, copper wire, and all of those things get fed into here to make the delivery cannon capsules. So that's exactly the same as I've done back on Norvis, but here it's a very, very specialised system, because this is almost all I'm doing on this planet is making these delivery cannon capsules. The other thing I'm doing here is taking the cryonite ore that I've been digging up, passing that through a pulverizer. Pulverizer here, then washing it in this one, I think. Then for some reason you take the cryonite, which the whole point of cryonite is that it's cold, then you cook it in the furnaces to turn it into the cryonite rods. That was not to reason why. That comes around here. We're making sulfuric acid, which you dissolve the rods in, and that makes the cryonite slush. Mix that with water here. It's all coming. All the water's coming from a pump over here on this lake, which is, you know, dead standard. This factory needs a fair amount of water, but there's plenty of it on this planet. That's nice and easy. So here we're turning that water and the cryonite slush into ice, which is getting loaded into this delivery cannon. And that's pretty much everything that's going on this planet at the moment. I don't have any other needs for cryonite at the moment, so at the moment that's all it's doing. And what that means is we've now got the delivery cannon here is linked up to the satellite dish, which is watching the picking up the signal from the other planet. And we've got a signal of 24,000 water and almost 300 ice. I can't remember what I'm triggering on. Let's have a look. Was I triggering on water or ice? I think it was on water. Yeah, so if there's less than 10,000 water at the other end, then this delivery cannon will activate. And at the other end of this delivery cannon, we have Myokin. Now, as you might remember, as I was saying in the last episode, we used to be collecting water barrels here. But water barrels have two frustrating problems. One is that they don't contain very much water. I think it's something like, is it 100? Let's have a quick look. Even worse, 50 water per barrel. So they only stack up to 10, so you can only put about 10 of them in a delivery cannon capsule. Then they drop in, and after they drop in and you empty them, you then have a big pile of barrels to deal with. And I was saying in the last episode, yeah, you can recycle them into steel, which you could then theoretically fire off with another delivery cannon, or just keep, because it stacks up much higher. But this way, with the ice, you don't have any leftover parts. The delivery cannon capsule disintegrates. You just get the ice into the delivery cannon chest. You can then put that in a chemical plant to melt it, and you get far more for your money as well. So instead of this stacks up to 200 instead of 10, and each one of those ices turns into 100 water. So that's 10,000 water per delivery cannon rather than 500. So it's literally 20 times better, and you don't have the steel to worry about. But you do have to go off to another planet and build an entire new factory in order to get the ice, though. So it's not exactly trivial. However, what this has done is it's allowed me to get my vulcanite processing running again, because that, as you probably hopefully remember, was getting through massive quantities or significant quantities of water, because the washing stage turns it into steam. And I was condensing the steam back down, but it was still only 90-something percent effective, so I was losing quite a lot of water in that process. But that means I have oodles and oodles of the washed vulcanite coming out. I can turn that into the vulcanite blocks. Those then get passed down here, where they're being loaded into this delivery cannon down here, and we're firing them off. Now, they're still not quite as... the power generation on this planet isn't quite as good as I would like it to be. I've expanded my solar out a bit this far, but then I ran out of solar panels and accumulators on this planet. So ages and ages ago, previously, way before I did any of the defences back on Norvis, I rigged up these accumulators to these comparators. So these are now checking. This one's checking to see if there's less than zero vulcanite blocks at the other end, and this one's checking to make sure there's at least 80% charge in the accumulators. As long as both of those are the case, then all of these will run and they'll keep the cannon firing. But I think at the moment we are actually at less than 80%, so that's why these have stopped loading the this up, and this is why that has run out and has therefore stopped firing. Once daytime rolls around again, which is going to be a while, you look at the we're still on the downward slope, sort of what you might call dusk, I suppose, where the amount of solar power available is dropping off relatively quickly. And these graphs are awkward to read because these scales in the bottom. Oh no, these are minutes. Okay, so each of these blocks is 3 minutes, and this is about three. Yeah, so in another 5 minutes or so, the sun will come back up. We'll get enough power. This whole planet, everything up here will start running again happily, and I can start hammering away with the delivery cannon again. That, as you may or may not remember, is going into this delivery cannon chest here. We've got the combinator here with the minus 1,000. So that's why it's saying if there's less than zero, because we've got the minus 1,000 on that one. And then they drop into this chest here and get unloaded onto the belts. And we've got these machines making rocket fuel. Now this has stopped, as you can tell. In fact, let's make that input priority left. Then it'll run off the delivery cannon by preference, and we can use whatever comes in by train occasionally to just sort of tide it over when there's not enough coming in from Myokin. So that then unloads the fuel onto here, and it goes out into the rest of the base as you'd expect. Here's a little bit of it going up here from the last deliveries before it got dark, and it looks like we are catching up. We're not quite at the point where I've got enough fuel, but it is definitely improving. So that the system is working. One of the other things I did have to do, because as I said, I got through that iron patch over to the side very, very quickly. So I added in another delivery chest here. Fortunately, I brought a couple of these along with me just in case. And this one is receiving iron from Norvis. So I've got on Norvis, I've got another delivery cannon that I squeezed in a really awkward place somewhere. where was it? Here it is. Yeah, so it's just stuck in a small gap here because I needed to be able to grab off an iron belt, and I didn't want to do too much building. So this works in the same way that the old one that was sending the water barrels over did. In fact, I can probably remove that now because I don't need to do this anymore. So let's mark that for deconstruction. I don't need any of that. In fact, let's do that as well. And I can probably instead of sending water up in this rocket in the future, I can probably send water up into orbit by a delivery cannon as well. That'd be nice. So this one is loading iron in as required. So here, how have we wired this one up? Okay, so again, if iron is less than zero, and what is how much iron is there at the moment on this? Where have I hooked this up to? There's 80 at the moment. Okay, so that's just fired. So he's keeping it topped up. So that's good. So this cannon here, this dish is linked to this transmitter, of course. And then here we've got the minus 2,000, and there's 2,000 in here. So that's just over 2,000 actually. So when we use up another 56 iron plate, which will get used up into the steel supply fairly quickly, it will get some more iron being delivered. And that's delivering. So effectively, this is going to provide iron this way to turn to steel. So I've got both coming from here, and then I don't need to worry about this anymore. Once this runs out, I can just demolish it and forget about it. All the other stuff I've got in situ, that one not so much. So yeah, that's working. I'm generally quite pleased with that. It didn't take as long as I was expecting. I suppose it's a relatively straightforward. There were the few hiccups, as I said, with the not getting as much power as I was expecting, and not getting as much iron on the planet as I was expecting. So I managed to sort those out. I suppose I could look into nuclear power. There's some uranium ore here, but to be honest, I don't think it's worth the hassle. As you've probably seen, if I look back at Norvis, nuclear power is fairly... Where is it? It's over here somewhere. Why am I not just using the map view? Nuclear power is a big job to set up. You need to have your uranium mine, which needs sulfuric acid. Now, I do have sulfuric acid up there already, because that's needed for making the cryonite slush. So I could mine the uranium. You then need to have some enrichment to build it up to get the good uranium out in suitable quantities. Then there's this, and then you make you need iron again. But then I've got iron now to make the power cells. Then over here you need all of this. We don't need all of this, not for a base that small. But you need a bit of this in order to produce the actual power. Although that said, all of this is solved problems, come to think of it. I've made all of this already. It's all being made on Norvis. That's where I got all this from. So it would be actually fairly straightforward just to take all the bits I need and some seed uranium-235 to get the Kovarex process running, and just shove it all in a rocket and take it up over to Frost. And then I wouldn't have to worry about running out of power, like, ever. What I think I'll probably do, I won't touch it for now because, you know, it's working. There's no point in fiddling with it at the moment. It is working absolutely fine. We've got plenty of power being made by these steam engines. So what I think I'll do is I'll link up some more of these miners so there's more coal available. So I'll just leave it running off this coal patch. However, when it eventually runs out, and I run out of power because the coal patch runs out, I run out of power from these steam engines, and it all just sort of falls down, and I have to go back and sort it out in one way or another. At that point, I'll come back and I'll get some uranium mining set up. I'll do it properly in inverted commas, and use nuclear power over here because that. It's almost a million uranium there, and if I'm not using it for weapons, that's going to last forever. Especially if I start doing sensible things and controlling the when I put power cells in and storing the excess power either in accumulators or in steam tanks, then yeah, that will last forever. I'm assuming that at some point in the not too distant future, I'm going to want to do a bit more on this planet because there's this beryl patch here. There's beryl patches scattered around it. How much we've got? Frost. Yeah, so we've got a decent chunk of beryl. So this might be an easier place to get it from than Myokin, because power is going to be easier to come by because we've got the potential for nuclear power here because we've got water. Whereas on Myokin, that's not going to happen. There's no water, so all the power has to come from solar, which, I mean, is... In a way, it's easier, but in another way, it's just a hassle, and you need to set up enormous amounts of it, and yeah, it's just a bit of a faff. So I think yes, probably coming up here for the beryl once I start wanting beryl is going to be a good idea. because most other things are here, sort of including iron now, to have got it being delivered like this. But that's to come later, I think. So that means there's going to be more stuff I can do with beryl, I'm sure. More stuff I can do with cryonite. There's probably going to be a lot of stuff I can do with beryl, and I'm probably going to start doing them on this planet. But I think the next thing I want to do is basically make a copy of all of this. No, copy. Basically this area. And start making delivery cannon capsules on Myokin. Because at the moment, there is a lot of them up there at the moment. We've got 11,000 of them, actually. So this isn't remotely pressing, but at some point, we are going to churn through them eventually. So I think at some point, I want to take up those 11,000. I want to make another extension to this base that will build me those delivery cannon capsules. And that takes, what was it, coal, iron... Oh, I'm going to need water. I've got water. That's probably not too much of an issue. That is a reasonable supply now. So I need... Yeah, I've got iron. I've got copper. I've got coal, although not in enormous amounts. Yeah, I could probably start making them up here. It's the oils for making the explosives and the plastic that's going to be the slightly tricky part. Now I could deliver coal by delivery cannon, but that seems extravagant. Not to put too fine a point on it, so I don't think I will do that. Ah, the delivery cannon capsules started up again. There we go, firing away happily. Yeah, I think I won't. I won't bring coal in like that. I'll harvest it on planet, since there are some reasonable supplies of it around. But I think that's actually quite a low priority, given that I've got 11,000 delivery cannon capsules on this planet already. I'm not going to worry about that for a while. So yeah, at this point, I honestly don't know what I'm going to do next. I'm going to have a look into options, I guess, and see. And the beryl is very tempting because it's something I've not looked at yet, and seeing what else I can do with cryonite is also quite tempting. So I think there's going to be one of those two, but I need to go away and do some research to find out what's the next thing to do. I mean, I don't even know what the next sort of science pack is at the moment. And I've got rocket science done. There's blue science. Is this one? No, I honestly don't know. So I shall go away and do some planning and have a bit of a think about what I want to do next, and I'll get back to you in the next episode. So thank you for watching. I hope you'll join me for that one, and we'll see where I go from there. Thanks for watching.